I had the spirit of wanting to fly very, very early. It goes back to when I was 5 years of age and I kept jumping off my daddy's barn with my Superman cape, trying to make it flap and landing in the hay below.
There are two words that you will never find in Wally Funk's vocabulary, worry and fear. What most of us would consider obstacles, Wally sees as challenges and opportunities.
Wally Funk was just 16 years old when her parents enrolled her at Stevens College in Columbia, Missouri, where her low grades brought her to the attention of an academic advisor.
My grades were just absolutely terrible, but I had an advisor that said, let's put you in the aviation of the modern world, and my grades all came up, and I've been flying ever since.
Wally chose to further her education at Oklahoma State University, becoming an award-winning member of their famous Flying Aggies flight team. After college, Wally became a civilian flight instructor for the U.S. Army in Fort Sill, Oklahoma. During this time, the space race between the United States and the Soviet Union had taken flight. After a series of extensive physical and psychological testing, seven men were chosen to be the first American astronauts, becoming known as the Mercury Seven. The tests were co-developed and administered by Dr. William Randolph Lovelace II, chairman of the NASA Special Advisory Committee on Life Science.
He had tested about 159 men, and they only got seven. So he says, well, let's see what the girls can do.
In 1960, Dr. Lovelace secured private funding for the Women in Space program, an unsanctioned program where women would undergo the same three phases of testing that the Mercury 7 astronauts went through. Dr. Lovelace began to seek out female pilots, inviting world-famous aviator Jerry Cobb to be his first subject. It was Cobb's involvement that caught Wally's eye.
Jerry Cobb was on the front cover of Life magazine, and I wrote to the doctors and asked, could I be allowed to take these tests? And within a hesitation, Dr. Lovelace wrote back and said, yes. I was the youngest. I was 21, and all the other gals were like 10 and 15 years older than I. So I was dubbed the kid right away.
In total, 25 women were admitted to the Women in Space program. Out of the 25 women, only 13 passed the first phase of tests, including Wally Funk. The 13 women are known as the Mercury 13. Wally was also among the three women to undergo phase two testing, breaking the record in the sensory deprivation tank. However, when Washington, D.C. learned about the program, the phase three tests were quickly canceled and the program was shut down.
They thought the woman belonged in the kitchen. Well, I've never been in the kitchen. I still don't know how to cook.
Even though Wally's hopes of being an astronaut were put on hold, she continued taking to the skies, resuming work as a flight instructor, and eventually becoming the first ever female air safety investigator for the NTSB. In the years since, Wally has continued to educate and inspire people of all ages, whether it is through her time as a Goodwill Ambassador for flight or through her work as a flight instructor.
Flying with Wally gave me a whole different perspective. Wally didn't teach me just the mechanics of aviation. She taught me the spirit of flying, to feel like you're in charge of your own destiny.
And Wally has never given up on wanting to still one day reach the stars. In the years after the Women in Space program ended, Wally continued on her own to complete many of the phase three tests that she never got to do. Her path even led her to adult space camp in the 80s. Then, in 1995, Wally and six of the other surviving members of the Mercury 13 were invited by astronaut Eileen Collins to attend the launch of STS-63. They were able to watch Collins become the first female shuttle pilot in history, all due to the contributions of trailblazers like Wally Funk.